This is Dr. Busti, and welcome to another session where I will answer an important clinical question. In this session, I will be addressing why is it that we can use Bactrim for urinary tract infections during pregnancy, but only in the second trimester and not in the first or third. I will also answer or explain why is it that there are contraindications in the use in the first trimester, which are actually different than that of the third trimester. And then lastly, and more importantly, pulling it together with what does the evidence actually say. As always, let's start off with a common clinical scenario where this situation might occur. We have a 28-year-old female, no real past medical history, but she's 16 weeks pregnant, and she's coming in with signs and symptoms of a urinary tract infection. She does deny back pain and vomiting, which is important because we want to decide if it's an upper versus lower urinary tract infection. Allergies, penicillin, she does report it being anaphylaxis, which is becomes relevant because that actually does remove an entire drug class of medications from our options. She's got a small temperature, pulse and blood pressure look okay, so nothing significantly alarming there. She has some suprapubic pain, but no CVA tenderness on exam. You look at her urinalysis, you see the common things that you would see in a for a UTI, positive leukocytes, white blood cells, bacteria that are present. So this is considered a complicated UTI given the fact that she's pregnant. Now let's stop and think as we're beginning to contemplate what is the plan going to be for this patient, knowing that she has an allergy. We have to consider the options that we have for the treatment of UTI. So the first one would be the beta-lactam antibiotics, the bactericidal agents, fairly safe in pregnancy. Unfortunately, we can't use that scenario in this patient's situation given her allergies. Fluoroquinolone antibiotics. Not all fluoroquinolones can be used for UTIs, but certain ones certainly can, like Cipro and levofloxacin. However, they are generally contraindicated during pregnancy. Fosfomycin, generally also contraindicated in pregnancy because most of its use and data is in uncomplicated UTI or cystitis in females. Nitrofurantoin and Bactrim would be other options that we have available. However, nitrofurantoin, just like fosfomycin, is generally only used for cystitis that is uncomplicated. And again, we're dealing with complicated. And so what happens is we've eliminated multiple options, leaving us really with this one. Now we have to ask another important question is what trimester is our patient in? Well, just to go back and remind everybody, the first trimester is the first 12 weeks of pregnancy. From 13 weeks to 26 weeks, that is that window for the second trimester. And then the third trimester is everything beyond the 27th week to the time of delivery. So our patient falls into the second trimester, and it's important to make sure that you recognize the breakdown there. So why is Bactrim contraindicated in the first trimester? And I'm going to tell you it's different than the third trimester. It really comes down to the ability of the body to make nucleotides that are going to be important for DNA and RNA. And if you look at this rather, you know, it's not super complicated, but if you look at this reaction, you'll see that basically what we're doing is we're trying to make tetrahydrofolic acid, which is necessary. And there's two enzymes that are needed to form with tyridine and PABA as it moves down and gets reduced. Well, Bactrim is made up of two different components. You have the sulfamethoxazole and you have trimethoprim. Both of those agents inhibit two different spots of this reaction. So sulfamethoxazole targets this reaction and trimethoprim targets this one, and specifically the enzyme dihydrofolate reductase, which is the same enzyme that is targeted by the drug methotrexate that we use for either chemotherapy or patients with rheumatoid arthritis, generally considered contraindicated during pregnancy because this affects cellular replication. So the main reasons in first trimester, teratogenic potential. The mechanism, organogenesis is occurring in that first 12 weeks, okay? So the organs are forming, they're differentiating into their proper tissues. And if we do anything to interrupt that process, we can impair cellular replication that then causes disruption of this organogenesis. So is there any evidence? Okay, what does the literature say? Well, I tried to pull some of the bigger or more recent data analysis of this particular question. And you can see that we have some conflicting information. There was a large database assessment in Denmark, and they basically showed a doubling of the risk of miscarriage, which would then imply that there was some damage to probably the cells in the DNA, and so that the baby or the fetus wouldn't able to survive. And then a database within the U.S. basically didn't see significant differences, but that was in cardiovascular cleft lip, palate, clubfoot, and urinary defects. It didn't include all genetic defects or even miscarriages. So you have to put things in the proper context, but there's some concern there, at least in this type of literature, that maybe something is going on. So what's happening in the third trimester? Well, it's the risk of kernicterus. And as you might remember, kernicterus is the deposition, especially early on after delivery, of bilirubin in the brain. It causes irreversible brain damage. Why might that happen with Bactrim? Well, the first is that sulfamethoxazole in particular can displace bilirubin from the protein binding sites. That allows the bilirubin to penetrate into the brain much more readily. The second is the risk of hemolysis. You don't know if that child or mom necessarily has an underlying condition called G6PD deficiency. And you may say, well, what has G6PD deficiency got to do with anything? Well, if you think about the mechanism in patients who are deficient, it makes sense. So normally, when a drug has a metabolite, it wants to get conjugated, or the body wants to conjugate it and get rid of it, make it more water-soluble so we can get it out of the body. Well, G6PD down here is an enzyme that facilitates the reduction of glutathione so that it can be used to conjugate with this metabolite so that the metabolite doesn't cause damage to the cell. However, when this process is missing, then that cascade of reactions goes away, and what ends up happening is the drug metabolite doesn't get conjugated, and as a result starts to locally damage the cell membranes of the red blood cells. That leads to hemolysis, and the hemolysis is important here because that leads to the breakdown of the red blood cell that leads to hemoglobin being broken down that raises the bilirubin, which can then go through the blood-brain barrier into the brain, increasing the risk of kernicterus. So the risk is twofold for that. Now, what does the evidence say about this? Again, a number of studies, some of them are older compared to some data analysis looking at a compilation of evidence, but some of these older trials are the ones that kind of generated some of the issues. So initially in this first clinical trial in 1956, they saw there was a significantly greater risk of death in these patients. Now, when they looked at a follow-up study of premature infants, they went and saw that there was a little bit of conflicting evidence for that situation at 2 years of follow-up. Other studies basically also say that maybe it doesn't likely cause this, looking at it from a meta-analysis or systematic review perspective. The point being is that there is some data that would be concerning. Historically, we've always avoided it. The pharmacologic risk does exist, and we certainly don't want to put undue exposure, especially if we don't know the underlying G6PD status of the patient. So in summary, in pulling things together about the use of Bactrim in anybody, but also in our patient, okay, because we could use it in our situation. She has no evidence of G6PD that we know of. She's in the second trimester. We don't have other options available, so it is certainly feasible. So as a summary, we generally avoid in the first and third trimesters, again, for those two different reasons. If the patient has a sulfonamide allergy, we would want to avoid that for risk of Steven Johnson's potential toxic epidermal necrolysis. It is also a known inhibitor of 2C9, which can then certainly cause a lot of drug interactions with certain medications that are substrates of that pathway. The one in the most important is warfarin or Coumadin, because it's the S isomer of warfarin goes through that pathway. We avoid in G6PD patients because of the risk of hemolysis. When the creatinine clearance gets less than 30, we really start need to making a dose adjustments or avoid its use altogether. We encourage fluid because it can crystallize when it gets concentrated in the urine, and it also can cause interaction, you know, with sunlight in the skin and cause adverse drug reactions that way. There is a small risk of hyperkalemia, and that comes with the trimethoprim component because it is structurally similar to amiloride. So there have been case reports of hyperkalemia that have occurred. Potential risk of pancreatitis, it has been reported in over 20 different case reports. And then, as we learned today, Trimethoprim is something that can impair cellular replication potentially, and so TMP can treat the bone marrow poorly, so it has been shown to cause bone marrow suppression. So hopefully you found that to be useful, but also easy to understand, clinically relevant, and evidence-based, and then obviously oriented to the patient.